This conference will now be recorded.
Good evening, everyone, or good morning, depends on your time zone. Welcome to the Cloud Performance Engineering in DevOps. And this is our first topic that we have. We have taken up cloud computing, and we'll be going over AWS cloud. Okay. So first of all, that's the entire syllabus, the course topic that we have, that we are covering as part of cloud computing. And it's a lot of services. We'll be going over all these services in a month's time, so dedicated, and all will be aligned to the performance engineering and performance testing. So how performance engineers should think about all these services, because all these things are very important to understanding. So first we'll be building up the concepts here. You'll be understanding what's the cloud. When I was designing this session, I have kept in mind that the audience is very new to cloud, or they have zero or no experience in cloud. So the course is designed in that way. So we are starting with very basics here: cloud computing, service models, IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, and then we'll be creating our account today, and then we'll be understanding how to do budget setup and how to create IAM user. First of all, we understand what is this IAM. It's one of the AWS services for the security. And then we'll be provisioning our EC2 instance. There are so many ways we can create instances. There are so many options that we have when someone asks us to create any instance, and how to connect to these EC2 instance. And then slowly we are ramping up. We'll understand the storage services that AWS offers, that is EBS, EFS, and S3. Then we'll talk about the most important of all the concepts, VPC. Very important to understand networking. If you understand networking, it will help you architect solution in cloud. So you will start your journey towards performance engineer if you understand, and towards architecting a solution in cloud. So VPC is the damn important topic here among all these things. And very difficult to understand as well. Okay. Mukit, again. Okay. Mukit, I'll take up that. Mukit, it will be taking again 10 to 15 minutes. We have explained that. If you go over my videos, I have explained enough about infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. So I would highly recommend you to please go over the recorded sessions. It's out there. I have done it quite enough. So yeah, because the audience here would not want to listen to this again. So please go over that recorded session. Thank you. Okay, so we have VPC concepts, and then we'll talk about the serverless services like Lambda, API service, API gateway, and SNS. What is this cloud formation, Beanstalk, then cloud concepts. We will understand what do we mean by high availability. Okay, what do we mean by disaster recovery? We'll understand all the cloud core concepts that we have. Then we'll talk about elastic load balancing and auto scaling group, the most important topic for a performance tester or engineer to understand, to configure a solution where you implement load balancer as well as the auto scaling group. Because once you set up your servers will be auto provisioned when you need resources. Okay, automatically that will happen. EC2 instances will be provisioned automatically when the extra load just kicks into your application. So we'll understand about load balancing and auto scaling group and CloudWatch, the monitoring part of it for performance monitoring. It's very important to understand CloudWatch monitoring. It's in-house feature, this AWS service, one of the AWS services out of the box from the AWS. And we'll understand about AWS CloudWatch, what is this metric, what all metrics we collect there, and dashboards, understanding logs, how to set up CloudWatch alarm, because eventually CloudWatch alarm will be required for the auto scaling group, and then events. So that's about the course detail, and obviously we'll talk about AWS X-ray as well. So that's about the course detail. Also, that's the data center that we have discussed about these things, and this is the cloud computing definition. So the accessing the resources over the internet. Okay, that's the cloud computing, and so when I say cloud computing, just imagine these two words, virtualization and automation. These are the two important words that should come to your mind, virtualization and automation. Everything is automated in cloud, and you are accessing the resources over the internet. you can do wonders sitting remotely. You just need to have an internet connectivity. That's it. And you can do wonders in cloud because everything is out there, all the resources that you need. You do not need to configure your data center. You do not need to purchase any hardware. Everything is there for you. You just need to pay some rent to the AWS cloud service providers. That's it. Everything is done. So simply put, cloud computing is computing based on the internet. You just need the internet connectivity. So that's it. And these are all the features, important features of the cloud computing. We have on-demand self-service. If you need more servers, get it. You will get it. So rapid elasticity. Yes, when you need the servers, you will get it. When you don't need the servers, they will take it back. And you will be only paying for the servers that you have used for that considerable amount of time. You'll not be paying for the time that you have not used the server. So pay as per use. That's what we call it in cloud. So that's the main benefit. That's why you see so many startups nowadays. They are not building, they have their applications, but they do not need to have their data centers to build their application, to host their application. They can use any cloud service provider and they can host their application, right? So we need to understand, as a performance tester, if you do not understand the architecture, what all components are there, how things are architected in cloud, if you do not understand the basics, then how can we troubleshoot any application, right? So that's what we'll be building up here. So that's the service model that we have, infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, software as a service. So it depends on how you use your cloud service. If you like for software as a service, like you don't own anything, you are not responsible. All the data centers, networking, storage, servers, virtualization, operating system, database, everything, all the components are managed by the cloud provider. You are just getting the software as a service. Example would be your Gmail, your YouTube, Google Slide, Google Sheets, whatever you have, you name it. That is a software service. It's one of the cloud service models in cloud. And then we have a platform as a service. Suppose if you want to just develop your application, right? You want to write the code and you do not want to have the underlying infrastructure. You don't want to worry about the underlying runtime environment, where you're writing the code, the runtime environment, and all those things. So you should go with this platform as a service. So the cloud service provider will provide you all the things that you require to code and to run your code. So you will be responsible only for your application. You will not be responsible for any of these things. The cloud service provider will be managing that for you. When you talk about infrastructure service, you get a control over a lot of resources. You get to control. As a customer, I get to control over the operating system, what operating system I need to use, what databases I need to use, the security of my databases or the applications and the application. I get to control so many things in infrastructure as a service, but the rest of the underlying hardware, the data center, the servers, the storage, the virtualization, all those things will be managed by the AWS or any cloud service provider. And that's the leftmost diagram. What you see here, that's your on-prem environment where you have to manage everything because you have set up the data structure, data center. You have purchased everything. You have to manage everything. You have to purchase data centers. You have to purchase land, occupy land. You have to build infrastructure. You need to set up a lot of, you have to do a lot of investments in the setting up the data center, right? And then at the end, you can deploy your application. So everything you manage here. So that's the difference between the on-prem setup and your cloud setup. Okay, I hope Mukit, I answered some of your, I think you wanted to go over this again. So I just took some time to complete this. Okay, and for more details, you can go over my recorded sessions. And then we have deployment models. And depends on the where the infrastructure of the environment is located. So I have these deployment models as well. Like there are many private players like cloud providers. They're offering private cloud. They're opting public cloud as well. For the public cloud, we have AWS and Azure, right? And we have Google Cloud. So those are the examples of public cloud. So anyone can host their application in their cloud. That's the case. That's why they're public. Anyone, if they have a data center, anyone can host their application in their servers. That's the public cloud. If you want data centers privately dedicated for you, you need to go for the private cloud. because in that data center, you don't want anyone to host their application. You just want only your application to run there. So that's that you have to go to public private cloud, and then you have to deploy the application. Similarly, we have a community cloud, suppose a banking firm or any group of any organization, some business people with same interest, right? They can join hands and then they can own one data center, and they get to only host their application in that data center. That becomes community cloud for you. And if we have an hybrid cloud, if you're using multiple cloud providers, okay, for hosting your application, maybe your application server in one of the cloud providers and your database or your web server or your other application components in other data in other cloud service providers. So basically you are using more than one cloud provider. So in that case, that will be called hybrid cloud. So hybrid cloud is the trend. You might have heard that in the on-prem, people keep their databases, but their application servers and the web servers, they host in some other cloud provider. So basically they are located, their infrastructure is located at multiple locations, right? So that's the example of the hybrid cloud as well. So if the infrastructure is located at multiple locations, that's the example of hybrid cloud. Okay, and then we have these three major players, okay, AWS, Azure, and GCP. Okay, and then I am just going through these slides just to recap you guys, because I have already covered this, and if you want, I've already covered this. You can go over my recorded sessions. You will find those things. For the market share, if you compare, the AWS has the biggest market share, like 33% of the market share, followed by the Azure, and then we have GCP, Google Cloud, and then we have other cloud providers as well, Alibaba, Oracle, IBM, and we have DigitalOcean. There are other cloud providers as well, but no one, because AWS enters the market quite early, back in 2008, they are the first player to enter the cloud market. So that's why they are the most popular one. Okay, and they are most, and they have all the data centers in most of the regions, they have it. So that's what the one of the reasons why they are popular. And if you look at the other cloud service providers, they are so much, even the Microsoft Azure, they are so much behind. So that is why the reason we are taking up AWS, because if you are going for an interview, you'll end up they would expect you to work in any of the cloud service providers. If you work in one of the cloud service providers, you can easily understand the other, but it's most case that they would expect an AWS knowledge from you. So that's why we have taken up AWS. All these concepts can be also taught by, can be taught using other cloud service provider as well, but we have taken up AWS. Yeah. Okay, so that's the AWS cloud history. So I'm not going to go over that. So they started back in 2008, they launched, and they have so many clients. Okay, so in the last session where we covered, last session was Linux. Okay, we discussed on Linux command line. Yeah, that's also the part of this course. But last to last session, I think on Monday, right? On Monday, I think, yes. Monday, I asked you to get one AWS account created. I hope everyone has that now, because we're gonna do something about it. And I have also created one AWS account. So we're gonna discuss about that now, okay? So to demonstrate everything that I wanted, even I have got one AWS account, new account created. Okay, I just thought it would be better for you guys if I create a new account, so that your account and my account will be the same. That would not be different, right? I'll be using the same account. Okay, so new account, fresh. Today we'll create it. Okay, so now the first thing. I hope everyone is getting this page, right? When you are signing in, you have the option. Let's see that. So you have this option, right? You get this option that either you want to sign in as a root user or IAM user, right? So first thing, because when you create the AWS account, you have this, you have used your email ID, right? And a password, right? To create, so that is a root user for you, okay? So always, so we have to, for the first time, we have to use one root user, okay? So let me use my root user, which I used today to create the account. Let me use the same email ID. Okay, I'm going to So that's my email ID I created today. Okay, so next, let me give the password of this. Okay, so that's the password. Okay, so it's the new account. So the first screen that you get when you signing using your root account is this, and here you can see that the root user is Roshan8586AWS2. Whatever you have given during the account creation, that will show up here. Okay, and by and here you get to see a lot of regions. Okay, a lot of regions means where your data centers, AWS has the data center, AWS has the presence. One region can have multiple data centers. In AWS, we call that AZ. Okay, I'm going very slow, guys. If you are new to this, so I'm going very slow. So see, for host your application, right, you need regions, right? So AWS has regions. So what you see here is the regions, okay? Regions, all our regions here, and even it's same thing is like, let me just go over the slides, few slides first. That's called AWS region. So to start up with, this was my first slide to start up with. You need to understand what the data structure mean. So when I say data structure, I want you to imagine a big building, a big infrastructure with so many servers. So that's one data center. And in AWS world, one data center is called AZ, A availability zone, AZ, okay, start with AZ. So that's what they call it, AZ. Other service cloud provider, use this, someone use availability domains, someone use some other names. So we're talking about AWS here. So do these things changes when I talk about different cloud service providers. These things only change. So when I say AZ, you should understand that I'm talking about data center. Okay, so when I say region, you should imagine multiple data centers. Okay, more than two. It could be six also, it could be three also, it could be four also, but it has to be minimum two data centers in one region, and maximum six they have it. Okay, so AWS region, that's what I mean when I say AWS region. Okay, more than two data centers, that is called availability zone. Okay, so each region has availability zones, usually three, minimum two, max six, and that's the name of their AZs. Okay, data centers. So in this example, I have the Sydney region where I have three data centers there, three AZs in Sydney region. Okay, so each availability zone is one or more discrete data centers. So, but roughly it is one data center. So just think of an availability zone as a data center. Okay, and they are connected all this in one region because they have multiple data centers, and all the data centers are connected with high bandwidth, ultra low latency networking, because there has to be very high connectivity, high speed connectivity among these three guys, because I'll be deploying my load balancer here, and my servers, one of the servers could be in one of the AZs and other server could be my another AZs. So I have to load balance. So they have to be connected with a high bandwidth, ultra low latency networking. It would be physical cable only. So understand, physical cable and other amplifiers and all those things they must have been using. Okay, so just know that the between all these connectivity among these data centers are based on very high bandwidth and ultra low latency. Okay, so I'll talk about this, guys. Okay, this guy some other day. Let me talk about the AWS console now. So when you log in using the root account, you get this screen first. Okay, and here you see all the regions that you have. Okay, currently we have around, if I have to just give you a thing, 24 launched regions they have around. Okay, so 24 launched regions they have it, and they have around 77 of data centers. Okay, they have it. So now you can understand 24 regions, right? If you count this thing, it will be around, if you it will be around that. That's called region. So usually I end up selecting the nearest region that I have, that's there for you. So currently I am located in Bangalore, so I select Mumbai region. So in Mumbai also they have a region. AWS has the presence in Mumbai also. So then they have the data centers, so more than one data centers, okay, in Mumbai region they have it. So I select that. So you can ask why, as you can select anything else, doesn't matter, just nearest to me. So I end up selecting. Okay, then you get to see a lot of services here. Okay, I'll talk about that. There are EC2 service, IAM service, billing service, a lot of cloud formation, a lot of services you see here. The first thing what we will do is we will do a budget setup, right? Because you have created an account, right? And you don't want to overbill, or you want to get yourself notified. Suppose now you think about as a company, you own a company now. Think like that. You own a company. Now you have got one AWS account. You are the root user now. I am the root user. I own a company. I'm the root user now. And now I'm going to give access to my employees to this AWS account, my AWS root, from my root account. I will give access to all my employees so that they can work. I have a bunch of developers, a bunch of testers, a bunch of DBAs, a bunch of DevOps guys. I have the entire team with me. Okay, now I'm going to give them the access. So think from that perspective, and then we will do that. Okay, so because if I own a company, I need to always know what's my budget is going on, because if developer is creating my resources unnecessarily, I need to have a check on him, right? So overall, I need to understand what's my billing is, because okay, fine, I don't need to create a data center. I'm saving a lot of money, but it doesn't mean I have to lose money, right? So I will do some sort of mechanism so that I will be aware of the pricing or the billing. So what I will do, I'll set up a billing thing first. So we have a service, okay? For any service, what you do, you type it here, okay? That's the best place you type billing, okay? Billing, okay? So what we will do, we'll set up a billing first, okay? That's the most important thing that we should do first, okay? Because it's a fresh account, I don't see any bill, but if you see my older accounts with it, because I end up doing a lot, you would see some amounts there. So $100 and all, you will see that. Okay, so that's fine. Okay, but let's do this budget setup. Go to budgets now and create a budget. Okay, everything is getting recorded, guys, so don't worry if you miss on something, you can always rewatch that. So focus on the big picture, what we're doing here. Don't remember the steps. Don't try to memorize the steps, because you'll have the recordings with you. For all the sessions, you'll have the recording. So I just went to budgets here, and then I'm going to create a budget. Okay, there are four budgets that I get. So cost budget, usage budget, reservation budget, and savings plan budget. Let me set up one cost budget first. So I have selected the cost budget. By default, it's cost budget is selected. Okay, so I am selecting the cost budget. Let me give any name, okay, AWS, since now we are learning, so AWS, so let me give this name, AWS Learning. Okay, monthly period, that's fine. I want monthly only, I don't want quarterly. Monthly is fine for me. I'll be notified about the bill that I incur on monthly basis. So recurring budget, that's fine, yeah, recurring budget. Fixed amount, that's fine. Monitor your cost against a specified amount and receive alerts. So I can specify any amount. So okay, now it's time to budget, to a budget session for my company, right? Let's start a bit. I'm not a big company. I'm just using this for learning purpose. Let me start up with $1. Let me give $1. Okay. So this guy's budget amount is blank. So let me go $1. Okay. So I have taken $1. Okay. If you can have, you can anything. I'm just giving you for any reference, because I want to really get notified, because they call it free tier, right? I want to check it out. It's really free or not, or what all services are free, and to how long, right? I want to check it out. So let's give this budget $1, and let me select all these things, include cost here to refunds, credit, whatever, anything you can select, everything you can select. That's fine, okay. And then what I can do, I can configure the threshold. I can configure that when do I want to receive one email. Okay, if I spend 50% of the allocated budget, actual cost, please send an email here. roshan8586.kumar@gmail.com. Let me just send email to me here. If I exceed the budget, 50% of alloc, if I would have allocated $1,000 there, when my billing would be $500, I'll be notified. Okay, so now you have reached your threshold that you have set this budget for, so you'll be notified. Just for a simple sake of getting, so 50 cents, right? $1. When my bill would be this much, I'll be notified. So I'll receive an email. I do receive a lot of emails, by the way, just for your information. Okay. So confirm budget, and then I can just create this budget. Okay. So now I have done this budget setup for me. Currently, I have not started using my account, so it's zero, right? So by the end of the session, you will see that I'll having something, a lot of things, because I'll be showing you a lot of things which are not free also. So I'll end up spending some money. That's fine. We will be learning a lot. So that's the first thing you should do. Second most important thing that you should do is you are root user. Okay. Root is the most secure account that you should always keep safe. I don't want you to use the root account. That's not the ideal way of using AWS account. You should create IAM user. So I'm introducing one more service in AWS. That's called IAM, Identity and Access Management. Okay. So once I go here, I can create users. And next time I will never be using root account, but that has to be very much confidential, right? You cannot mess up with your root account. You can mess up with your IAM user, any user, okay, but you should not mess up with your root account. So that's the important thing. Okay, so what I will be doing, I'll be creating users here. Okay, and then suppose now I'm talking about a company setup, right? So what I'm asking you, because I need to group people, because now I have hired so many people. I have hired 100 of people. There are developers, testers, performance engineers. There are some DBAs. There are DevOps guys. There are configuration management guys. There are so many developers of different my modules. Okay. I have a lot of operations guys, a lot of people I have in my organization. So I want to group them, right? So I will be creating groups. And then I'll be creating users. Then I will be creating policies for that groups. Policies. I will not be giving, because here is the time I have to give permissions. I can provide permission. I cannot give administrator access to everyone, right? They will mess up my account. They can do a lot of services. I'm smart enough to provide of only limited access to a developer, because I know what the developer role is. Not think like an admin, okay? Think like an admin. We are trying to learn cloud here. We need to think like this as well. So think like an admin, that developer should not have more access, right? Or anyone should not have the admin access. Okay, currently I have logged in. I am the owner of the company. I have logged in, but I don't want to use my root account, right? Let me create an user for me only, okay? So let me create a group. So I'm going to create a group now, group for the admins, okay? You can give any name. I just happen to use administrator, admins. So I'm creating a group, admins, and I'm going to assign myself to this group. Next is that I need to attach some policy, okay, to this group. So I am administrator, boss. So let me give this administrator access. Okay, I should have all the accesses possible. So let me give this administrator access. I'm the admin. I can give other accesses as well. A lot of every accesses. That's fine. But the admin access is the most important one. I can get to do a lot of stuff here. I can, because administrator. So they are the admins guys. So depends. There are standard policies. So it depends on the group that you are creating, for group for a developer, group for a tester, group for a pipeline. There is a role, there is a policy called a data pipeline. If it's a DevOps guy, I would give this guy here. If they're using Kubernetes, so I would provide this policy. So again, depending on what group I'm creating, so I need to attach policy in the groups. So whatever we are discussing, right? So these are very, if you're looking for certifications as well, right? In the cloud, AWS certifications, cloud practitioner and architect associate, solution architect. So if you're looking for those certifications, these knowledge are very important. They will simply ask you, you create policy for what? Users or groups? If you get confused, you're gone. So there will be questions like that. So you create policies for the groups, not for the users, okay? You attach policies to groups. So I have attached this policy now, administrator access now. Okay, that's fine. I can create this group. So I have a group now of admins with administrator privileges, administrator policies, right? So now I'm going to create one user. I'm going to create a user. I want to be that user, right? So I have given one name, a user. Because this is the place where I give my people, my employees, the auto-generated password or custom password. Because since I am creating this on my behalf, so I can set up my own password so that I don't get this auto-generated password and then I have to change the password. So let me give my custom password, whatever I want to get it. Okay, the custom password looks like I don't have the option, is it? Okay, can I write this? Yeah, fine. Okay, I set my custom password. I'm not going to tell you guys. But if you do not want to do that, because if you're doing for any other people in your organization, you can do auto-generated password and then you can proceed. They will be receiving one email with some random password. Then after in the first login, they get to change the password, as simple as that. Because I know that I'm going to be the user, so I have given my preferred password. I'm just skipping one step. That's it. Okay, so next permission. So permission, yeah, administrator. I want to be the administrator. So I have attached now, I have included, I have added my user to the group. So the first step was I created the group admins. Now I'm creating the user and I'm also adding the user to the group. Okay, so I have done that. Let me give a name tag. I can give any tag. I can skip this also. Doesn't matter. Name. Okay. Any tag. Key value pair. My first user. Whatever. I can do that. Anything. That this is optional field. Okay. Optional. Review it. I can review it. Okay. So I have given administrator guys. So this is my user. So I have given the administrator. Require password reset. Okay. They're asking yes. That's fine. So first user, let me create the user. Okay. So the user is created now. I'm going to download this CSV. Very important point. I should not mess up with this guy here. Okay. So let me just do one thing. Let me show in folder. Okay. I have got one CSV file, guys. So just know that is open in my other window. That has my account, all the account details. What I'm going to do, I'm going to save it here in my AWS2 account. I'm going to save it here, paste. Okay, I just got these credentials. Okay, so I pasted it here. I just safely somewhere, I have pasted it. So that's the account detail I have it. And I can also send one email, send email. I'll be also notified. Okay, that's fine. I do not need, that's fine. Okay, and now, I am the Roshan user created now. Yeah, let me close this as well. So all these details, what you see here, access key ID and secret access key, that is there in this CSV. You should keep this CSV safe. You would need that. That's why I have saved it in a secure place. And let me close this. So now I am Roshan. I have created one user and I have added this user to the group. So wonderful. I have done that. Okay, what next? Let me go to the dashboard. You want to secure your account, right? So to do that, let's do this enable multi-factor authentication, because we are in the root account. okay, I don't want to mess up with my root account. It has to be secure, fully secure, right? So let me configure multi-factor authentication. For that, you need to install, if you're having one Android app, you need to use a Google Authenticator. You can search in your mobile, if you have iPhone or Android, so you can just look for Google Authenticator. Okay. Let me just search it for you. You can type this Google Authenticator. You should get one application, okay? Android and iPhone both should be there, okay? So what you can do, this is the I'm talking about. You should download this guy here, okay, and have it with you. That will be required, okay? For the iPhone also, for the iPhone users, so I think you should also get this iPhone, okay, iOS, I think you should have in the Play Store, Apple Store. So yeah, you need to install this guy here, Google Authenticator, on your mobile, okay? And then one token will be generated, okay, every 15 seconds, okay? So you need to, so let me do one thing. I intended to enable multi-factor authentication, right, for my root account, because I want to keep my root account safe. I don't want anyone to hack it, right? So let me enable this, activate. I just clicked on that. Now I'm clicking on activate MFA, okay? I am getting this option, guys, so virtual MFA device. I'm going to select this, and I'm going to click continue, okay? I am getting this QR code now, okay? I'm going to scan this QR code in my Google Authenticator application. You do that in your own time. We have this 2 days time to do this, okay? So I'm going to scan it, okay? You need to click on the plus symbol in the Google Authenticator. There is a plus symbol, you'll get it in the very first page on your bottom right. So I have clicked on first. I'm going to scan the QR code. So I have scanned the QR code and I have got one password, okay? I have got one token. So I have to provide that token, 019451. This keeps on changing, so it's super safe. And then I have to wait for some more seconds. I have to get the second token also. So two for token, what it's creating, I have to put these two tokens to create my multi-factor authentication. I just got my second token also, 438185. That's fine. I'm going to assign MFA now, okay? That's successfully done, close. So I have successfully assigned my MFA now. So now my account is fully secure. Now what I can do, I can log out. I'm log out now, okay? If I try to log in now, next time, let me try using root account only. So let me use the same credentials that I use, okay? I'm going to use the same credentials that I used, root account, that's the root account. Next, I'm going to give the password that I used last time, sign in. What I'm getting now, multi-factor code. I have to look into my mobile. I have to open the Google Authenticator app and I need to give the current token. Then only I'll be allowed to log in. Now I could log in. If I will not provide that, I will not be able to log in. So that's how I made my root account safe, right? So now I'm all good. So there's one more thing, guys, I want to tell you, IAM. In the IAM, there's one more thing. See. This is called your console. So that's the URL of your console. For all your employees in your company will be creating users for the employees, right? They will be getting their account, their username and password in their email IDs, right? They will get it, okay? But they have to know this link also, because they will be using this link to signing into their AWS account. That is a part of your root account only. So you are providing them the access, right? You have provided them the email, username and password. They have to use this this link here, okay? That's the signing URL for IAM users in this account. So what you have, this is called the account ID, 22651, whatever the number you see here, that's called account ID. I can mask this account ID as well, and I should. I don't want to reveal this account ID to all my employees, right? I don't want to do that. What I can do, I can give a custom email ID, okay? Custom, I can give one like custom alias name, right? Let me give also an 8586. AWS 2. So you can just, you are just masking the account ID. So this will be reflected. This could be a company name also. Suppose I own this company, whatever name it is, abc.com or whatever. So you can give this company name and you can create this alias. So what it will do, it will replace the account ID with your alias name. So now next time I will ask my employees to use this user, this signing URL to log in using their IAM credentials. So currently, you just look at here, I am root. So that's why this is where the root looks. Let me show you how it looks when I will use as the create as the, when I will sign in as the IAM user. So let me sign out. I'm going to copy this. Because I will need this guy, okay? I will need this URL. So you copy this somewhere, save. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to sign out, okay? I have signed out. Now, next time if I log in, right? I'm going to log in using the same signing URL for the IAM user. Okay, now I'm signing in. Okay, I already get this. I get this by default. Maybe I would have used this username, but even if you do not get this autofill, that's fine. You have to provide the same account ID because you have masked the account ID, right? With your custom name, you can provide that. You have to provide your company employees to use the IAM user that they want to. You have allocated them, right? You have created this for you, and they can use the password. For the first time, if they're using the this password, okay, again they're asking me the same thing. So your company will have to also do the same thing, okay? Your company employees. So for the first time, it will ask you the password. You can change as per your comfort. Let me hold password. Let me go to the same Excel sheet. There I think I should have the password with me. Let me open this guy here. Let me open this guy. I hope I have this. Let me just. That's the secure information, guys. So let me just check this. Okay. I don't get this. Let me just some other files. Okay. Let me give the old password. Let me give the new password. Okay, now it's working. Okay, that's fine. So now if you see here, you see that I have logged in as the Roshan. Can you see this guy? Now I'm no more root. I have logged in as the IAM user. That's important. I have logged in as the IAM user. Okay. So that's cool, right? And you should always do that. You should not use your root account. That has to be super safe. Okay. And now I'm logged in as the IAM user. Now you can do whatever you want. Okay. So the first thing that we would do, we'll create our EC2 instance. So there's one service that's called EC2, okay? That's called one of the first services that AWS came up with was EC2, okay? EC2 was one of the AWS services, first AWS services they came up with. and they call it Elastic Compute Cloud. So you have to search it here, EC2. You can find it also, but it, let make it a habit of searching it here for all the AWS services. They have plenty of services. Let me give you an idea. You just, whatever you see here, these are so many services they have it. A lot of services, a lot of developer tools. So everything you can think of, they are, and it's developing, it's ongoing process. They are not done yet. No cloud provider has is done yet. Okay, they are, all the cloud providers are working day and night to develop their cloud service provider, because the more the service they offer, the higher the customer base they have. So now they have storage services as well, S3, EFS. We'll talk about all these things. And they have the machine learning services as well, Amazon SageMaker, augmented AI. So a lot of them. Okay, you have to have this cloud. Cloud service provider knowledge, anyone, it's very important. They have a lot of services. So we are just talking about one of the services, EC2. What we will do, that's the first thing that we need, okay? We are gonna explore and talk about it. Okay, so that's the EC2. When you open EC2, you get to see this window, okay? And I'm already selected the Mumbai region. You can select any region, okay? That's fine, okay? What we are going to do, we are going to launch one instance here. We're going to learn how to launch one instance. So let's launch the instance. Let's go to the, so if this is the EC2 dashboard. If you look at here, they have, see, Mumbai has three AZs, AZ1, AZ2, AZ3. Three AZs is there in Mumbai region. If you select any other region, let me select US East Ohio region. Okay, I have selected that region. I can create the EC2 instance there also. Just imagine the power. I am somewhere else located, and I have this option, this flexibility of creating one instance in a data center which is located in Ohio region. That far from me, I can create one instance, one VM in that region, in US East region. So that is what cloud offers you. So that is what, and you have, and I have not invested anything. I have not invested data center, I have not purchased any servers, but I get to provision one instance, I get to provision one VM sitting remotely that far. That's the power of cloud. Okay, I can create anywhere in the region. Okay, I can go to EC2, I can just click on launch instance, and I can go ahead and create it, and I can do wonders. I can host my application there. If my application base, if I'm designing one application, and if my customer base happens to be in US customer base, so I would like to have host my application in US region, right? So that my customer get the best of response time, best of throughput, because the request and response has to travel very less, right? So that's the idea. And they have other options as well. It's not like if a Australian customer would like to access the same application, they would get a very bad response time. Nothing like that. They have this concept of cloud front as well. Points of presence, they call it CDNs. You can also configure that. Okay, we'll talk about those things slowly. We'll talk in depth. So let me select the same region that I have selected, Mumbai. So no, nothing. It is nearer to me. That's why I selected this. That's fine. What you can do, you can create instances. Click on that instances, and what you can do, you can just launch on the instance. Now select on free tier. Now you get to see free tier means, why do you want to spend, right? You're learning, so let's learn in free tier only. That's why you have this account in free tier. Now you have the option. Now you have to select one AMI. That's called Amazon Machine Image, AMI. That's the operating system, basically. What operating system you want to leverage, you want to use in your instance. Now I get to select that. I have so many options, Red Hat, SUSE, Linux. So many options I have. I can have Windows, all the options, Windows Server 2019, 2004, 16 base, a lot of options I have. If I uncheck that, I will get even more options, right? I'll get even more options, but let me select free tier. and let me just explore that I'm getting so many options, and let me select one. Okay, I have just 10 minutes with me, so I need to we'll cover that again in the next session. Okay, but let me select this this particular operating system. I've selected this operating system. Now in the next page I get to select the instance type. So now I have the option of selecting the instance type. What instance type you want to select? There are a lot of options. So when I say instance type, I mean how much you want to have CPU and how much you want to have memory. That's important, right? For any performance engineer to understand how much is the CPU and how much is the memory of your server. Because you'd need that information and to benchmark and to suggest what's the right instance type in the production you should push or you should suggest, right? So let's use this free tier eligible. Let's not talk about that more. So this is the free tier eligible T2.micro that has only one vCPU and just 1 GB RAM. Okay, I have options till I cannot even imagine. 48 CPUs and 384 GB RAM. This will be heavily built if I provision this. Okay, I don't have any region to select that. So we are just learning here. So I can go with this three tier eligible T2.micro, one vCPU and 1 GB RAM. And let me configure. So I now in this page, I have option of configuring instance details. I can select the VPC. We will talk about VPC a lot more. We have 1 week of full dedicated session in VPC. VPC is very important concept to learn if you want to architect a solution and your application in cloud. We'll talk about that VPC. We'll create our own VPC. By default, they have this VPC, right? For the internet connectivity, they have to have this virtual private cloud. So let me just go over this quickly now. So I have selected this one instance I want to create, and I can also get to select which data center I want to create instance in. Even that option I have. In the Mumbai region, I have 3 data centers, 1A, 1B, 1C. I can get to select where do I want to provision the instance. Let me use 1A. I can also use no preference. That's fine. It will be selected randomly. Let me select 1A. Okay, let me click on. I'll talk about these details again in my next session. Okay, let me just walk you through this this process. So add storage, and by default you can have 8 GB. This is the disk. We have provisioned the RAM, 1 GB of RAM. Now we are talking about. See, we are customizing our instance. That's the power that we have. Sitting remotely, I can customize my instance. How much CPU I want, how much RAM I want, how much disk I want, I can configure. Where, which AG I want to provision the instance, what's the my virtual private cloud. So I can configure a lot of things, right? So let me use 8 GB by default, whatever they have it. Let me just complete this process, okay? Let me give this my instance a name. Let me give this name a name. First instance, any name you can give this. First instance, you can give anything name. I'll talk about these options again. Okay, so there is something called security group, line of defense. Who all get to access your EC2 instance? Who all can access? Because eventually in that EC2 instance, you're gonna deploy the server only, right? You're gonna install the server, your web server, your application server, your database server. So you have to provide who all can access your server, right? So that's the security group for you. I'm just talking to you in brief now. I'll be talking about in detail security group, okay? We have a long 2-3 sessions related to security group. So let me just give this access, SSH, because I want to use PuTTY. PuTTY to SSH, because I want to have a connection. I want to create a connection. I want to connect to my EC2 instance. If you recall my last session, I was connected to the EC2 instance, right? That EC2 instance happens to be Linux, and here also we are provisioning Linux, right? And then we were trying so many commands, right? And I can also install any server. So same thing, SSH is required, because SSH, if you do not give this, If I delete this, I cannot even SSH. I cannot even use PuTTY to connect to this. So I have to use this SSH. Let me select an existing, whatever, like new security group. Let me create a new security group. Let me call this SG1. Okay. I have created this new security group. Let me call this name security group, first security group, whatever. Okay. First security group. I hope you guys are following. If not, no worries. We'll cover this again in detail. Okay. But things are simple here. So I'm just creating a security group. I have given this description. I can skip this also. And I have to give this SSH credential. And suppose if I want any port, suppose I'm planning that in that EC2 instance, I'm going to install web server. Let's call Apache. And I know that Apache 2 HTTPD, they listen on port 80, right? So I have to enable port 80 as well. So let me give this, let me allocate, suppose if I want, let HTTP, and I have by default only it has taken 80, and this is called anyone can access the world. Again, I will talk about this. This is called CIDR. Okay, this means that anyone in the world, any IP can access this. Can access this server on port 80. So anyone can access the port 80. So I am allowing the access to the server on port 80 because I know I'm going to expose a web server on port 80, right? So I have done that, and let me call this web server, web server access. And that web server happens to be Apache 2. So I'm just pre-planning that. I need not do that, okay? But let me just do that, okay? Maybe I cannot demonstrate this this today. Maybe I will demonstrate this tomorrow. What's the importance of this? So I have just given this additional access, but this SSH is required to even PuTTY. So let me review and launch. Okay, that's fine. That looks like fine. That this is okay. First step, I did. I have this Ubuntu now. I have T2.micro, 1 vCPU, 1 memory, and in the security group I have this at least, so I can SSH. Even I have 80 port. That's good. So my 80 port is exposed to the, all the IPs. Okay, that's good. Instance details, storage, I know, launch. While launching, I have to create one key. Key is required, okay? I have to use one key. I don't have any key right now because it's a new account, fresh account. So I have to create a new key. So let me give some name, unique name. First, key. Let me give today's date of what is that? 22/01/2021. That's fine. First key. So I've given this name. What I can do? I should download this key pair. Okay. I have downloaded this key pair. And what I can do? This I have to keep it safe. Okay. Let me open in folder. So I am going to cut this and I'm going to paste it here. Okay, so this is the place. So this is the key which got generated. This is called .pem file. So .pem file got created, got generated when I downloaded the key. I just clicked on download and I got this .pem file. This .pem file is here now. Okay, so let me launch the instance. So I am launching, my instance is getting launched now. I can go here and I can see now, this is my instance, first instance, right? And this is getting provisioned, but it will take some time to provision. It will not take more time. It will take some time to provision. Meanwhile, what I have to do, okay, I need additional 5 to 10 minutes. Shall I take this today or next day? Are you guys okay with today? Can someone confirm me that? 10 minutes. How to connect to EC2 instance?
Yeah, it should be fine.
Yeah, Roshan, okay for me.
Okay, can someone else confirm? Good?
I'm also fine.
Okay, Anjali, thank you. Okay, so let me just go over that. So my instance is running now, okay? My instance is running and I have the my PEM file also that is required to get connected, okay? And I have given in the security group port 22 access, that is for the SSH, right? So now this instance is running. So in this instance, what you see here, I'm going to demonstrate this again in the next session also, but I'm going to rush this up and I need to finish that in 10 minutes. So for this instance, I have the public IP. Public IP is what you can access over the internet. So public IP is public IP. Anyone, it's available over the internet, and this is the public IP address, and that's the private IP address. So that is available within the VPC. Okay, so let me do one thing first. So I have got the PEM file. I have to create one PPK file also. Okay, I have to create one PPK file from this PEM file. To do that, I need to have one software. So what you guys need to do, you guys need to install PuTTY. Okay, if it is for the first time for you, if you're hearing this word PuTTY, so you let me show you that you have to go to Google. It's open source. You don't have to pay anything. You just to download PuTTY. Okay, that's it. Whatever Windows, or you have to download this guy, and PuTTY.org, that's the first link you get. You have to go here and you have to download this PuTTY. You can download it. Once you download this, you get the entire. Okay, for Mac, there are other ways to do that, Harish. Okay. Oh, but yeah, we can talk about that in for Mac, right? We'll talk about that. Okay, so there are other ways also to connect. So if you see here, my AWS account, you can connect here from here also. See, you can directly connect. If I click on connect, I EC2 instance connect, I can connect also. Okay, so I can talk about this, how to use this. Okay, so let me talk about this. PuTTY is the most common, I think, for Mac also you will find one. You know, is it not there for you? Let me just Google it for Mac. I have seen my friends using it. How come it is not there? Yeah. So PuTTY for Mac OS, download it. It is there, please. So you just need to explore this and you will have it. Okay, there are other ways to do that. You need to install. You can do that. It won't get installed completely. Okay. I will give you the other options. Okay, don't worry. Okay, in my next class, I will give you the next option, how to connect. Okay, so let me go over this today, PuTTY. So fine, what you can do. Now you have to create one PPK file. Okay, so from the PEM file, can someone go on mute? I hear this. Can everyone go on mute, please? Oh, thank you. Yeah, so what, now you have this PEM file with you. Okay, what you have to do, you have to create PPK file. So to do that, you have to search for, once you install PuTTY, you will get PuTTY-gen. Okay, PuTTY generator. So you have to open as a run administrator. Oh, I don't know what I need. I opened the folder itself. Okay, let me use this PuTTY-gen. You open as a run administrator, and what you do, you load your PEM file. Okay, my PEM file is here, right? In this location, what you do, you load this PEM file. Load PEM file. What you do here, you come here, okay, and then you search for your PEM file. Okay, PEM file is there, right? Same PEM file that you downloaded. You open this PEM file and then you get your PPK file. You save your private key. Okay, yes, without passphrase, you save your whatever the name you give, first key. Okay, so whatever name you give, and you have to append that with PPK. Okay, so PPK file is required. Okay, now in this location you have a PPK file as well, so you would need this PPK file. Now PuTTY key generator work is done. Okay, what you need to do, you need to log in PuTTY, run an administrator now. Okay, and what you can do, you can now provide your public IP. So my public IP is this. I'm going to copy this. Okay, let me select. What you need to provide, you need to provide your public IP here. You can also give your name here, first instance, okay, and you can give your today's date, okay, so that you remember that that's your thing. And you have to do connection, make it some number, well, 90, so that it doesn't log out. Go to data, you have Ubuntu, you have to type Ubuntu because you have provision Ubuntu instance. You have to type Ubuntu. If you would have provisioned Red Hat or Amazon 2 AMI, you should have typed EC2 user. Okay, so remember this EC2 user. So, but now I have provisioned Ubuntu, so I have to type Ubuntu is the default user. Okay, that's it. I'm all set now. I'm going to save this profile now and I'm going to load this up. You see that I have this profile now, first instance, right? I'm going to click on open now. See, yes. Okay. Something went through. Okay, I have not given the private key. Good. The private key I have not provided in Rust. Okay. So what you have to give, that's why it could not get connected. Okay. So let me first instance. And in the private key, you have to provide, you to come to authenticator here, auth, okay? And you know that your private key location is here, right? You have to come to auth, you have to browse, okay? And you have to provide your private key, PPK file, because that's the key, it listens, okay? You downloaded the key PEM file, you have to create your PPK file. And that's what you need to configure in the SSH, under the auth, which is under the SSH. Now you should see this. This is my PPK file, same PPK file that I have created. Now what you do, you save this again, so that I don't have to do this again, type this again and again. So I have saved this and I click on open. Now it got connected. So this is my EC2 instance, guys, which got connected. Perfect, right? Now let me just change this for your benefit. Okay, so this is the EC2 instance. If I do a host name, okay, host name hyphen I, if I do that, you get this private IP. You can match it up, 172.31.43.37, right? 43.37. Is it the same private IP you have it? Yes, 172.31.43.37. Yes. Now you can install whatever you want. If you want to install a web server, application server, database server, you can install anything. So next session, I'm going to install a web server. I'm going to demonstrate that. I will host that web server on port 80, right? And in the security group, I will talk about that the security group that we created this SG1, if you recall, and I already have this 80 port added. We'll talk about inbound rules and outbound rules, and I already have this port 80. If I do not have, I will show you, if I do not have, what will happen and why do I need to have port 80. I'm going to demonstrate this in the next session, which will happen on Monday. So that will be the plan. I'm going to install a web server in the same EC2 instance that I have provisioned right now. I'm going to talk more about the security group. I'm going to create the EC2 instance again. I have not talked to you about more, many options on the way. I'm going to create the EC2 instance again on Monday. We'll talk more about this, because we have just started. It is provisioning the EC2 instance was just the starting thing. We have lots to cover, okay? So that's all I wanted to cover today. Thank you everyone for joining the session. If you have any questions, feel free. I'm done for today. Yeah, thank you.
Roshan, can we install multiple instances?
Yes, a lot of them, a lot of them. There is no limit as such. You can create in any number of services. And only thing is that more the service, more the resources you will use, the more you will be billed. Only thing is that. Obviously, you can have n number of servers. That is not a problem.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Okay, so that will be the plan for Monday. We're gonna take this forward. We're gonna learn a lot more things on Monday. Thank you everyone for joining. Yeah, I'm going to stop the recording now. Thank you.